worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Touching every heart, I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. 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 Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. 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 Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome today to our worship service here at First Brethren Church. It's so good to have you here with us today as we prepare our hearts and our minds for worship today. This week we have, let me double check here. We have our normal meetings, Executive Council on Tuesday, our Bible study on Wednesday, and then some memorial services next weekend. And I think we have a renewal of vows today too. So you can read it. I don't want to do your reading for you. You can do that yourself. But just so good to have you here today. As we begin our service today, I want to use the scripture from Colossians 3:16 as the opening today. And it says in Colossians, "Let the word of Christ richly dwell within you, with all wisdom and admonishing one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing with thanksgiving in your hearts to God." There was a book written several years ago called Worship is a Verb. And God's really been laying it on my heart that we get out of worship what we put into it. And worship is truly a verb. So when we're together on Sunday mornings, we need to prepare our hearts and our minds for what we're going to do during this service today. If we're praying for somebody, pray in your mind and take that home with you and pray for them during the week. If our worship team is leading us in song, sing along and let those words refresh you. There is nothing like refreshing of mind and soul like singing music. And I know that because I spent a lot of years doing music as my job. And yesterday when I was working, one of those songs came on and I started singing. And one of the ladies came up to my counter and she goes, "You know that really, really well." And I said, "I know the people that wrote this song." And I said, and she goes, "That's beautiful." And I said, "Well, I'm just doing my part." So those are things that people remember. You can touch people's hearts that way. And just come in here with that presence. And my friend Mark Hall wrote a song. And this has really been on my heart too. It's called The Healer. And the lyrics in the song go like this. "It's hard to see the storm blowing over anytime soon. It's hard to hear any hope in the headlines. And a lot of the headlines, I don't know what's true. We've been trusting in the broken to make us whole. But there's one new thing we need, and we need the rescue. And there's one thing we need. We need the healer. We don't need another hero. We need the healer. And only Jesus is the healer." That is so true. And we all know, and we've been praying many, many prayers in this congregation, that God is the true healer. We don't need another television hero or a movie hero. We need Jesus. So let's keep praying that today. Let's pray today. Lord, we just love you today. We just are so glad we can be here today physically. And if we can't be here physically, we're so glad we have the venue of FaceTime and Instagram and the ability to watch us online. I'm excited to hear today, number one, what the worship team is going to bring us in song, and I'm also excited to hear what Pastor Dave's going to bring us in message. May we truly be encouraged by what we hear. May we truly be worshiping as worship in the verb. Worship is a verb, and we need to be a part of it, not just a spectacle in it, but a true part of it. Lord, thank you and praise you for today. In your name we pray, amen.
Let's stand together this morning as we sing out praises to God.
Feet of Jesus, the greatness of His mercy and love at the feet of Jesus, and we cry, holy, 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 and we cry, holy, 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 and we cry, holy, holy, holy. Fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus, the greatness of His mercy and love at the feet of Jesus, and we cry, holy, 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 and we cry, holy, holy, holy.
Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, a name above every other name, Jesus, the only one that could ever save, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you,
Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will
we praise him this morning. What an amazing love our God has for us, for what he did for us, to give his son to die on the cross for our sins, something that we could never earn and never deserve. And we praise him this morning. This I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Sing it out to him.
Deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch's treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know. With all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Amen. And you may be seated.
I love that song, "The Sacrifice Jesus Made. His wounds have paid my ransom." I get teary-eyed just thinking about it. I have some praise reports today. You all have been praying for these people, and I want to update you. We have both of Gracie's family that were in ICU last week are out. One has gone back to the nursing home where he had been, and the other one went back to his home. So that's a praise report. Praise God. And we have Richard Robinson, who's had cancer. He is now testing cancer-free. So we are very, very grateful for that as well. And I believe I heard that Jacob and Lisa are here somewhere. There they are. It's hard to see with the glare of the lights up here. I'm so glad you can be here today. And what a joy to see Jill back singing. Isn't that awesome? She's had kind of a tough time in Arizona, and she's back with us and happy. Hopefully the pain will stay away. So we'll keep her in our prayers. Those on cancer that we want to continue to pray for is Daniel White, Mark, Ava, Christopher, Heather Fred, Amy Terreri, Catherine Dublin, David Moore, Michelle Demko, and Martha Jackson. For other health issues, we have our Lisa and Jacob on the list. We want to continue to pray for them, not only for the grief that the family's going through at this time and for Evan as well, but for the pain that Lisa and Jacob suffer on a daily basis, just to get around, just to move. And I know Patty deals with some of these same issues. So we pray for her as well. Also Maria, she's here today, but some days it's really hard for her to get here. And we are thankful that she's here today. And Washington is needing our prayers for health and for salvation. And for Connie, for Wendy, for Brenda, for Rochelle, for Estrella Morales, for Billy Barth, for David and Dorothy Deckmar, Carwin sisters, for Anita and Beverly, Nancy Strasser, Danny Wright, Eleanor, Mark Teets, and Mark Teets is gradually improving. He's the one that had the TIA problems, with the lack of oxygen for a short period. And our John Showalter, I understand he's at the rehab center again, and he is rebounding. He's able to get up now and work on the program of getting better. So hopefully, prayerfully, he will get well and get back to us real soon. We also want to continue to remember our world in prayer, that Satanism isn't going to win Christianity. God's love is. So let's keep them in our prayers. The world, the Christians in the world, that we stay strong. And also the family and friends of Diana Scribner, who died, and of Steve Yoy. Thank you very much.
So wonderful to hear what God is doing in our congregation and around the world. And like I said at the beginning, we play a part in that, and how we pray, how we prepare our hearts for prayer. I was talking to a guy yesterday, and he said, you know, a lot of the things we took for granted when we were growing up, our parents would teach us, and we don't get that as much anymore. And I'm like, you're correct, we don't. But we can teach each other as believers, and just like Jesus taught his disciples, you know, go out and do this, and do this in remembrance of me. So we need to remember that today. Also want to praise God for friends. I hooked up with Wayne and Linda Messenger, people that you've have been in this church for years. I saw them the other day, and we had a good time talking and reminiscing about old times. And it's good to have Becky with us here today. And I thought it was her when I got up here, and I'm like, I don't want to say anything. And during the worship, I'm like, that's Becky. I'm going to say hi to her. It's good to have you here today. And it's just so good to be here today when Iris went over the praises and the prayer concerns. We have a lot to be thankful for. We also have a lot that we need to pray for. So before Pastor Dave comes to share with us, let's bring our hearts to prayer. I'm going to leave a little time at the beginning, and then I'm going to finish it for us. Let's pray. Lord, I am so excited today to be here today to hear, number one, to hear what the worship team led us in, and I'm preparing my heart for what Pastor Dave's going to share with us today. Lord, as you brought us here today, through what we heard from Iris today, we know there are a lot of praises and prayer concerns we need to continue to lift up, not only in our congregation, but around the world. We have people that we know that are traveling around the world. I know Pastor Tom is over in Africa right now, and Tom and Julie were with us in the winter time, and he's traveling and reaching out to students and people in Africa right now, Lord, and just be with him and bless him and bless Julie as he is away for a while. And Lord, we just, it's so neat to talk to people and to know that they're out there serving you and making a difference in your kingdom, Lord. May we all do that in everything we do, whether it's in our job or at school, or if we're visiting in the hospital or whatever we're doing, Lord. Not so much what our words, but what our actions are, Lord. People are watching us and seeing what we do as believers in you, Lord. And I just pray for divine wisdom in all that we do and all that we say, Lord. It's just such an opportunity for us in these days that we live in. As I said before, the harvest is ripe, but the workers are few, and we need to be one of those that are going out there and bringing people to a saving knowledge of you, Lord. Give us the power to do that. Open up our hearts, our minds. Give us the exact words and the people we come in contact with in our lives this week and in this year. Lord, we just lay it all at your feet at the altar today, all of our concerns and all of our passions and everything, as we open up our hearts and minds for you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Mike. It is good to be with all of you. It is good to have Jill back. I think people are more excited to have Jill back than when I came back last Sunday. But that's okay. I am too, so I'm glad for that. We've been going through the story of Elijah and then Elisha. And we've gotten to 2 Kings chapter 5, where we have the story of a healing. And I think this goes beyond just the story of healing. It's an amazing miracle, but it's also something that can be instructive for us today, you know, 2,500 years later. So let's go to 2 Kings chapter 5, and we'll start off with just the first 6 verses. Now Naaman was a commander of the army of the king of Aram. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him the Lord had given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Now bands of raiders from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel had said. "By all means," the king of Aram replied, "I will send a letter to the king of Israel." So Naaman left, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of Israel read, "With this letter, I am sending my servant Naaman to you, so that you may cure him of his leprosy." From the beginning, I think this shows us some important aspects of God and this world. Number one is that God blesses godly people from all nations. Sometimes people get offended to hear that the people of Israel were God's chosen people. And I've tried to explain that before, that this is not a choosing of value or a choosing of these are the people that I will work with and I will forget all the rest and destroy all the rest. God chose Israel for a purpose. One person I heard describe it this way: if you tell your son, "Go and call your sister to come to supper," your son is your chosen vessel. But that's not just for his blessing, that's for her blessing as well. He's just the one that's tasked with the job of going to get her. And then both of them will come and eat. And that's what God has chosen Israel for. God has chosen Israel to be an example to the world, to reach out to the world, to be a city on a hill, to draw all people to God. And even in the Old Testament, even the scriptures that were written from a Jewish mindset, from that aspect of separation from all the other nations, it says that God is a God that's too big to be just the God of Israel, but that all nations should worship him. And Israel is just the vessel for that. Not only was Naaman not a Jew, but he was a captain in the army of the king of Aram. And if you remember these stories of Elijah and Elisha, Aram was their enemy. And yet God showed his favor upon him. He said he was a man great in the sight of his master and highly regarded. Okay, that's one thing. Because he had been given victory. He was a valiant man. But it also said, through him, the Lord had given victory to Aram. Even when they were fighting Israel, God had given Naaman victory over his people. And the reason was because Israel was totally in rebellion against God. And the most gracious thing God could do was to punish them, to bring them back to a relationship with him. And that did work. But here God used Naaman, and because of that, he had a wonderful reputation with his leadership, with his country. He was a valiant soldier. But all of that paled in comparison to one fact about Naaman that trumped everything else. But he had leprosy. You know, we still have in our collective consciousness the whole problem of COVID. And not only the illness that some people went through very severely, but also all the social distancing that we had to go through and shutting down businesses and shutting down schools and everything else because of this feeling that everybody was a danger to everybody else. Can you imagine that multiplied many times with leprosy? But it was only a small group of people that had to deal with that. But if you had leprosy, you were put in a separate colony. You weren't allowed to associate with even your family. They couldn't have contact with you, or else they would be considered unclean as well. It broke relationships. It broke work and businesses and everything else when you had leprosy. God's favor does not guarantee freedom from problems. Naaman was blessed by God in order to give him victory, but then Naaman got leprosy as well. It doesn't say that Naaman did anything to deserve this. It doesn't say this was a punishment from God. It's just, here's a good man that God used in a good way, but he had leprosy. That's the world that we live in. The effects of sin extend to all of us, and we're all susceptible to illnesses and accidents and other kinds of problems. I think probably if we polled everybody here, we could probably find probably more problems here than we have people here as we're facing problems in this world, because this world is a fallen place. It's a cursed world, and Naaman had leprosy. I think it's also interesting that Naaman and the servant girl had a surprising relationship. Isn't it kind of surprising? She's been kidnapped, taken as a servant for Naaman's wife, and yet she hears he has leprosy, and she said, oh, if he would just go to my own country, there's a prophet there that could heal him. You could tell that even in this less than ideal situation, she cared for her mistress's husband. Oh, if only he went there. He would cure him of his leprosy. And the interesting thing is, Naaman takes this seriously. He says, oh, if you say it, I better do it. Maybe part of this is grasping at any straw you can get. You know, when you're facing something that you don't have a solution for, sometimes you'll go to any great length in order to solve it. But there was at least something about this servant girl that he looked at her and he said, well, if you say it, I'm going to act on it. And he went to his king and said, hey, this is what my servant girl said. And the king acted on it. Somehow Naaman was convincing to him as well. And not only did he say, by all means, go, but he gave him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. This is a fortune. This would have set anybody up for life. You could retire and go to Hawaii. They didn't know anything about Hawaii back then, of course, but you could retire anywhere you wanted to and just live a life of ease from that point on. That's how seriously Naaman wanted to be healed. And from all accounts, it looks like it might have been the king that gave him all of this. And it's like, I want you healed as well, because he was so important to the king. So they traipse off over to Israel. They cross the enemy lines. They go into Israel, and he goes to the king. He carries a letter from the king to the king. Basically, hey, my counterpart over there, you work this out for my man. Saying, this will be like a favor to me. In verse 7, it says, as soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robes and said, am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? See how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me? When Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his robes, he sent him this message. Why have you torn your robes? Have the man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel. So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him to say to him, go wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored and you will be cleansed. But Naaman went away angry and said, I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed? So he turned off, and so he turned and went off in a rage. The king of Israel thought, this is just a pretext. You know, they're going to come and they're going to attack us and say, why didn't you help my servant? You know, we thought that we were neighbors. You could have been a good neighbor. And so the king of Israel is thinking, hey, he's going to attack me. This is just a setup, because how can I cure him of leprosy? And I love Elisha's answer, send him to me and then he will know that there is a prophet in Israel. Naaman would never know anything about the God of Israel by going to Joram's palace. He wouldn't find God in Joram's palace. Joram was an ungodly king. And you can tell he had no faith in God. He didn't say, okay, well, I'll send you to one of my prophets. He never even thought about that. He was a totally faithless man. And Elisha was like, send him to me. Then he'll know there's a God in Israel. Then he'll see what God can do. So he does go to Elisha, and he comes with his chariot. I love how it describes it here. He says, so Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. So you got multiple horses and multiple chariots all coming up. It's a whole entourage coming up to Elisha's house. And the door opens. And I guess they're expecting some big production. And a servant comes out. And he says, hey, Elisha's in there. He tells you, go wash 7 times in the Jordan River. And you'll be cleansed. And Naaman's like, what? I've come all this way and you can't even come out? God is not controlled by our rituals. He expected some fancy ritual, maybe with some incense waving around, and he wanted him to wave his hand over the spot and say some words, and he wanted magical incantations because he thought, that's how you get things done in the spiritual world. Elisha wasn't having anything to do with it. He's like, yeah, go wash in the Jordan River, it'll be taken care of. And not only that, but what's the Jordan River? I've been to the Jordan River. I remember our guide talking about going to the Jordan River, and he said, I'm kind of embarrassed to take you to the Jordan River. He said, I've been to the United States, I've seen the Mississippi, and I realized that Jordan is not a river. The Jordan is kind of like an irrigation ditch now. It's just this little stream of water. It's not a very big thing. It probably was bigger back in the time of Aram and Israel, but it's still a minor river. And he's like, what's so special about this Jordan River? How's that going to help me? He was expecting so much more. But God is not controlled by our rituals. 1 Peter 3:21 talks about baptism, and it says, and this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also. It sounds like baptism is what saves you. But then he goes on to write, not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience toward God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ paid for your sins, and when you give your life to him and pledge your clear conscience to him, that's the power of that baptism. Baptism has a power because it symbolizes the washing of your soul that God does by the blood of Jesus. And if you don't have that, you might as well not get baptized. If you go in just as an unrepentant sinner into the waters of baptism, you go in a dry sinner, you come out a wet sinner, and nothing else changes. Baptism doesn't have any saving power from the physical act. It's what symbolizes what's already inside that has the power. It's not the ritual. God gives us rituals. Don't make any mistake about that. God gives us rituals, but they are to reinforce the reality of what is behind those and what those rituals signify. The Bible, many places, talks about how God is not impressed with our sacrifices. The people of Israel would take an animal and they'd slaughter it and they'd put it on the altar, and all that happened was they were one animal short if their heart wasn't repentant before God. It's the work that God does inside of you that counts, and the power of the ritual is to point to that. So why was Naaman going off in a rage and unwilling to even try? He brought all of these riches. He'd come all this way. He'd crossed into basically a country that was at odds with his country and that he had battled against. In fact, his servant girl was kidnapped from this country. He'd gone all this way, went to the palace, went to Elisha's house, and then Elisha tells him what to do, and he's like, what good is that going to do? And this man who is willing to grasp at any straws, even at the word of his servant girl, isn't going to do it. I'm not going to do it. I think the issue is pride. This man was used to going around in chariots. I just imagine him going around with these little flags, you know, like the diplomats when they're driving around town and they have flags on their car that are waving and great pomp and circumstance and everything else. And he was used to people bowing down before him. He was used to commanding people. And then this Elisha sends out a servant to tell him, go take a bath. And you expect me to do that? And he goes off in a rage. I think it's his pride. And that's an issue that many of us struggle with. You can't simultaneously serve God in your pride. C.S. Lewis said that pride is the foundation of all sin. And the more I think about it, the more I agree with him. I think in every sin, you're not going to commit a sin unless you have a portion of pride in that sin. Because any sin you commit, if you knowingly go against God's will, you're saying, I know better than God. Or I don't care what God says. Or God may forbid this to other people, but it's not important for him to forbid it for me. Or other people may not be able to handle this sin and get them in trouble, but I can. Every single sin has at its core pride, because it says, I'm the one who decides, not him. And so pride is a very dangerous thing. God has room for every single one of us in heaven, but he doesn't have room for any of us in our pride. Now let me say, when I talk about pride, we use that word for different things. And I think there's, in some ways, pride can be a good thing. People talk about pride in the sense of being, taking seriously, wanting to do things right. A desire to do things well. So if somebody does a job and you say they take pride in their job, I think that's a wonderful thing if they take pride in their job. They take pride in the way they look. That can be a good thing or a bad thing. But if all you're saying is, you know, they present themselves well, that's a good thing. Another way we talk about pride is having pride in other people. People would say, I have pride in my kids and my grandkids. You probably get sick of that, but that's not a bad thing. Now, if you think my kids are better than anybody else's and I hate all other kids, that's a problem. But if all you think is, I see the good in my grandchildren and in my children, and I'm happy with how they're living their life, that's not a bad form of pride. Maybe we could say that pride, when it becomes a bad thing, is the kind of pride that says that in some important way, I'm better than other people. I am more important than other people. I am smarter than other people. And for one thing, that can cut you off from God. For another thing, it can cut you off from everybody else as well. It's hard to maintain that, because the reality is, we're pretty much alike. And I may be better at some things than you, and you may be better at some things than me, and everybody has their own talent list and gifts. But because of that, we all have some claim to a little bit of fame. The Bible talks about that being, you know, we're gifted in different ways by the Spirit, and that's why we can work together. Because we're all of the same value to God, but I may have a different role than you do because God's put me in that position and given me gifts for that. And God has put you in a certain position and given you gifts for that as well. And it's a wonderful picture of what God intends for humanity to be like. But when we get into our heads, no, I'm more important than others. No, I'm smarter than others. Or any other category you can think of, then that cuts you off from other people. For one thing, if I'm smarter than others, then nobody else can tell me anything. For one thing, I'll never learn anything because I'll never believe anybody else, because obviously I have all the answers And what you say can't change my mind because obviously I'm smarter than you are. And so the proud person never learns anything from anybody else. Or if I'm more important than everybody else, then you're all just actors on my stage, and your only value is what you can do for me. And that's the opposite of what God wants for us to do, which is love others. Love says, you know, you may not be any more important than me, but I'm going to act as if you are. I'm going to treat you as if you're important than, more important than I am. And so pride, I think, is probably the number one enemy of love. Pride gets us into trouble in all sorts of ways. If I think I'm smarter than everybody else, then somehow I have to keep that up. And if we get into an argument, I could never say, oh, what? You know what? You're right. Because that would go against my pride. And I think that was what Naaman was struggling with in this. He was used to people catering to him. He was used to having all the fancy stuff. And he couldn't handle just a simple instruction. Here's all you have to do. You would think it would have been easy for him. In fact, his servants are going to say, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? You know, if you're going to do something really, if he told you to do something dangerous and difficult and all that, you would have done anything. He just told you go and wash seven times. Why not try? But he was used to being catered to. He was used to having everything being a big production for him. I think a lot of people deal with this with grace as well. You know, the whole message of the Bible, the core of our faith, is that you're not saved by your works. You're not saved because you're a good person. The core of Christianity is not that good people go to heaven. The core of Christianity says there are no good people, and so we're all saved the same way, by God's grace. His favor that we do not earn and cannot earn is how we are saved. Why is that a hard sell? Why is that something that everybody isn't just drawn to? And so many people feel like they have to still work their way to heaven. And you talk about grace, and sometimes people get upset about it. And I think the reason is that we want to take credit for ourselves. We want to say, no, I saved myself. No, I'm a good person. I deserve God's favor. And it's hard to let go of that pride and be humble and say, God, I'm a sinner. I need your forgiveness. Grace can only come to the humble. The Bible says, humble yourself before the Lord and he will lift you up. A lot of people want to lift themselves up. But God says he brings down the proud. I'd rather have God lift me up than lift myself up. So let's not try to take credit for our own success. Let's not be the one that has all the answers. You know, if you have a special area of expertise and you can help people, go ahead and use that. But if you find yourself being the expert at everything, probably people aren't going to want to listen to you anymore. And so, you know, let's dial that back a little bit and say, what do I really have to offer in this world? What are my gifts and talents and abilities? God says, don't think of yourself more highly than you ought, but think of yourself with sober judgment. Meaning, don't think of yourself in a negative way, but just think of yourself in an honest way, with sober judgment. Verse 13 tells us, Naaman's servants went to him and said, my father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, wash and be cleansed? So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan seven times as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. Then Naaman and all his attendants went back to the man of God. He stood before him and said, now I know that there is a God, there is no God in all the world except in Israel. So please accept a gift from your servant. The prophet answered, as surely as the Lord lives whom I serve, I will not accept a thing. And even though Naaman urged him, he refused. If you will not, said Naaman, please let me, your servant, be given as much earth as a pair of mules can carry, for your servant will never again make burnt offerings and sacrifices to any other god but the Lord. But may the Lord forgive your servant for this one thing, when my master enters the temple of Rimmon to bow down, and he is leaning on my arm, and I have to bow there also, when I bow down in the temple of Rimmon, may the Lord forgive your servant for this." I think one of the wonderful things is Naaman's illness led him to a faith in God. Why did Naaman have leprosy? Why did God allow this good man to get this terrible disease? Well, we may not know all the answers, but we know at least one thing that came out of it. His soul was saved. So we see that right here. When he heard about this, he said, "Now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel. No God except in Israel." And so, because there's no God in Israel except in Israel, he said, "I'm not going to worship any other God ever." And when Elisha wouldn't even accept a gift, he said, "Okay, well, give me a load of dirt." Kind of an interesting request, wasn't it? As much as two mules can carry. I think you see what he's doing, right? He's taking some dirt from Israel so that when he gets back to Aram, he can make this little plot of land in Aram that is Israel transplanted. And he said, "I'm going to worship the God of Israel. That's where I'm going to bow down and worship God." He'd seen the results. It changed his life. It changed his eternity. Naaman's illness had led him to faith in God. I love how he said, "You know, if I bow down because I have to help my master down, may God forgive me." And Elisha is going to say, "Go in peace." 2 Kings 5:19 and following, "Go in peace," Elisha said. After Naaman had traveled some distance, Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, the man of God, said to himself, "My master was too easy on Naaman the Aramean by not accepting from him what he brought. As surely as the Lord lives, I will run after him and get something from him." So Gehazi hurried after Naaman. When Naaman saw him running toward him, he got down from the chariot to meet him. "Is everything all right?" he asked. "Everything is all right," Gehazi answered. "My master sent me to say, 'Two young men from the company of prophets have just come to me from the hill country of Ephraim. Please give them a talent of silver and two sets of clothing.'" "By all means, take two talents," said Naaman. He urged Gehazi to accept them and then tied up the two talents of silver in two bags with two sets of clothing. He gave them to two of his servants, and they carried them ahead of Gehazi. When Gehazi came to the hill, he took the things from the servants and put them away in the house. He sent the men away, and they left. When he went in and stood before his master, Elisha asked him, "Where have you been, Gehazi?" "Your servant didn't go anywhere," Gehazi answered. But Elisha said to him, "Was not my spirit with you when the man got down from his chariot to meet you? Is this the time to take money or to accept clothes or olive groves or vineyards or flocks and herds or male and female slaves? Naaman's leprosy will cling to you and your descendants forever." Then Gehazi went from Elisha's presence, and his skin was leprous. It had become as white as snow. The Bible says that godliness is not just another get-rich-quick scheme. Gehazi thought it was. Elisha obviously didn't think it was. He could have legitimately taken that whole treasure because he did what Naaman wanted him to do. But he said, "No, I won't accept the thing." He wasn't in it for the money. Gehazi was. 1 Timothy 6:5 talks about "in constant friction between people of corrupt mind who have been robbed of the truth and who think that godliness is a means to financial gain." I think that's the health and wealth gospel, is the idea that, you know, if you serve God, he's going to make you rich and healthy. He's going to give you everything you ask for. And again, that's an aspect of our pride, that I'm going to serve God in order to get what I want, when really we should serve God because what we want is God. Are we gold diggers for God? You know, do we want a relationship with him just because of what we can get from him? Or do we want a relationship with him because we want a relationship with him? Psalm 73 is a beautiful psalm about that, where the psalmist says, I look at all these wicked people and I see how they're prospering, and I think, what do I get out of all the service that I've done for God? And then at the end of the psalm, he just says, now I realize not only that the last chapter hasn't been written in their lives and they're going to fall away, but he said, whom have I in heaven but you? And earth has nothing I desire except for you. Meaning, when I serve you, God, I get you. And that's all I need. That's the reward. So Gehazi decides, hey, he let him off too easy. He should have taken that. I think Gehazi obviously wanted the money, but maybe he also wanted to humble Naaman a little bit more. He let him off too easy. And so he went and got some money from him. Again, Gehazi's living with pride. It's not about rejoicing that Naaman was healed or being happy that Elisha, his master, has shown this great miracle from God. But it's like, what do I get out of this deal? I know what I'll do. I'll go and ask him, hey, Elisha, he changed his mind. He's got some guests. Can you give us some money? Can you give us some clothing? And Naaman is generous. It's like, sure, take two. You ask for one, take two. And he gives it to him. And Gehazi lives to regret it because he gets the leprosy. If your religion is all about you, you aren't serving God. And so if we can't let go of our pride, then we'll never take hold of him. We need to humble ourselves before him and say, God, you are God, and I am not, and I will serve you. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you for this beautiful story of the beauty and benefit of humbling ourselves, letting go of our pride, and standing before you, not claiming anything for ourselves, but just offering our lives to you. Thank you, Father, that you are even willing to accept us. And thank you for your love for us. I pray, Lord, your blessing on each one as we seek to love you more and love you more purely. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is Take My Life and Let It Be. Would you stand as we sing? And then right after we have this hymn, we're going to have a celebration. It's Dave and Patty's 25th wedding anniversary, and we're going to celebrate with them with a renewing of vows. So let's all stand together. Take My Life and Let It Be. If you need any prayer or anything, our altar's open as we sing. if you would remain standing for just a moment, Patty's going to be escorted by her brother.
Day after day, I must face a world of strangers where I don't belong, and that it's strong. It's nice to know that there's someone I can turn to who will always care. You're always there.
Dave and Patty, this ceremony is a reminder of what when we stood in this very same place, the three of us, and you pledged yourself to each other. And anytime you go into a wedding like that, it's always with like a world of hope that you could be seated for just a moment. It could be it's always with a world of hope that this relationship is going to last, that the vows are going to be something that you hold on to for your whole life, and that you're going to be a blessing to each other. This is a little bit different. 25 years later, we don't have to have the faith anymore because we've seen the sight. We've seen that you guys have been together for 25 years, and that you have been a blessing to each other. I think it's made both of you have much better life. And so we're celebrating that today with you. Many of us were witnesses at that wedding, and so we're here today for the same thing, as you say the same vows together that you said back then. And so I'd like to ask you, David, if you'd repeat after me. Why don't you hold hands together as we sing, as we read these? I, David. Take you, Patty. Again. To be my wedded wife. And I do promise and covenant. Before God and these witnesses. To be your loving and faithful husband. In plenty and in want. In joy and in sorrow. In sickness and in health. As long as we both shall live. And Patty. Take you, David. Again. To be my wedded husband. And I do promise and covenant. Before God and these witnesses. To be your loving and faithful wife. In plenty and in want. In joy and in sorrow. In sickness and in health. As long as we both shall live. Patty and Dave, your relationship has been a blessing to each other, and it's a credit to both of you and to God. David, as you place the ring on our finger, say, This ring I give you. In token of our abiding love. And as you place the ring on his finger, this ring I give you. In token of our abiding love. So by the authority committed to me as a minister of the gospel, I declare and reaffirm that you are husband and wife. What God has joined, let no man separate. You may kiss the bride. God bless. May God bless you and keep you. This concludes our service. God bless.
If every word I said could make you laugh, I'd talk forever. I asked the sky. Forever.